Good morning. Join me in the Easter proclamation. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come to you this day to be fed and to be freed. Show us our salvation in the depth of our being so we can never again be the same. Roll away the stones that keep us from all that is true and right, that we might live without pretense or fear as followers of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let's begin our worship today by singing all stanzas of hymn number 143, Now All the Vault of Heaven Resounds.
Thank you.
Good morning. Join me in the invocation with the response parts. We begin this worship as we began this day in the presence of our God. We have been given the name of God to call upon in days of struggle and days of celebration. We use all our breath as we continue to celebrate the joy of Easter.
We begin anew each day in the name of our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Hymn number 304, stanzas 1 and 4.
This morning you'll notice that we have our lesson to be read before the Reader's Theater. So would you
Lesson for today is from Acts 3, verses 13 through 20. The God that Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and our other ancestors worshipped has brought honor to his servant, Jesus. He is the one you betrayed. You turned against him when he was being tried by Pontius Pilate, even though Pilate wanted to set him free. You rejected Jesus, who was holy and good. You asked for a murderer to be set free, and you killed the one who leads the people to life. But God raised him from death, and all of us can tell you what he has done. You see this man, and you know him. He puts his faith in the name of Jesus, and was made strong. Faith in Jesus made this man completely well while everyone was watching. My friends, I'm sure that you and your leaders don't know what you were doing, but God has his prophets tell that his Messiah would suffer, and now he has kept that promise. So turn to God, keep your sins, give up your sins, and you will be forgiven. When that time will come, when the Lord will give you flesh, strength, he will send you Jesus, his chosen Messiah.
Now it's time for our Reader's Theater. You may be seated. We're going to break into six parts, and I don't know how we can divide six, but we're going to try group one here. Group two will be kind of in this little cluster. As you know, the choir is left on tour, so there seems to be some gaping holes. Usually, it's a pretty good attendance by choir members. So that's group one, group two. Group three will be this little pocket in here. Dan and Stacy and Mark and everybody. That's group one, group two, group three. Group four will be back in that side of things. Group five will be the last couple of rows in this section, and then group six will be everybody else. Group one, group two, group three, group four, group five, and group six. So please read where you see your number. This is the world that God made. Oh, excuse me. We got to stand up. When you read, you stand up, and then you sit down. Okay? Okay. We are students and faculty with visions and dreams. I am the person with the breath of God, a student or faculty with visions and dreams.
A gospel lesson for people of God who are out of breath from John. And the disciples were afraid of Jewish leaders, and on the evening of the same Sunday, they locked themselves in a room. Suddenly, Jesus appeared in the middle of the group. He greeted them. He showed them his hands and side. When the disciples saw the Lord, they became very happy. After Jesus had greeted them again, he said, I am sending you just as the Father has sent me. Then he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they will be forgiven. But if you don't forgive their sins, they will not be forgiven. Well, I wanted to play with you a little bit this morning with the Reader's Theater about ups and downs because I thought, gosh, what a way it is on a Monday. And then you come, and I mean, you're the chosen group who come to worship in the first place, and how special you are. And then to have somebody like me want you to go up and down and up and down, and to get out of breath, and you got all kinds of other stuff on your mind, and it's the close of the year. You're focusing on getting this all over, and there's so many things going on in your life, and you got a fast pace. And isn't that true? The way we live, things go up and down, and we just get out of breath. And here we are. In the second celebration of Easter, hallelujahs, with organ and trumpet and Easter lilies and banners and people and angels and archangels. It takes so much breath to shout hallelujah. What do you do when you're out of breath? Because there are things that happen in our life to even Easter people that just knock the breath out of you. You know what it's like to have the breath knocked out of you? Many of you have experienced this. I remember one time, I was trying to, before I married my wife, I was trying to impress her family, and a huge family, 9 brothers and 4 sisters. And we're playing this family football game, and I'm running out to catch this pass. I was a wide receiver, and I knew what I was doing, but it was long past I could do what I thought I used to be able to do. And I had my eyes fixed on this touchdown. I ran right. This is in a farm in Illinois. And I ran right full speed, eyes on the ball, and you never lose your concentration, right into a guy wire of a telephone pole. Hit it right across here. Hit it so fast, it was just like a cartoon. I went around it twice. You know? And laying there, and it just knocked the breath right out of me. Now, when the breath is knocked out of you, it's like dying. But you're very sophisticated people. And in my mind, it said, well, Dick, I think it would be your advantage if you would start breathing right now. But there was, and my mind, it was fine. Just breathe. But my body was going, I couldn't. Until, and embarrassing as this was, that my future wife's brothers had to come and put breath back in me. There are just times that when the breath is knocked out of you, it's like dying. And even for Easter people, and what do you do when you're Easter people to shout hallelujah and you've had the breath knocked out of you? It happens with people who are up and down and going so fast, and things that happen in a relationship and they get broken, it just knocks the breath out of you. Al Seek was a marvelous young pastor in Nebraska, one of the best youth and family people we had in Nebraska, and I got to know him really well. What a gift could this man shout hallelujah with his family. Had two children of his own, had adopted two other children. I was just with him about 2 years ago. I was just with him 2 weeks before this happened. And I held his new children. They just had a new baby that they adopted, and it was only 7 weeks old. Beautiful. And I held the baby, and I played with Ruth, the next oldest, and I read Bible stories, and these kids were, I love kids, and they're all over my lap. We took them out to dinner, this marvelous pastor. Just a few weeks later, an event that knocked the breath out of us. Their pastor of a little town in Nebraska, little town, Class C school. The girls' basketball team was playing in the state tournament. They won the state tournament. But the night before the finals, after the game, the semifinal game, as they're going home, there Al and his family had a collision with an 18-wheeler. And he and his wife and two of the four children were killed. Benjamin now is 11. He lives in a nursing home for the rest of his life. Matthew, who had most of the bones broken in his body, looks like he'll make it, but he lives with an uncle and aunt now. Just knocked the breath. I just held those children in my arms 2 weeks before that. Just knocked the breath out of us. And it was about this time of year. Knocked the breath out of us. And we cried. He was such a marvelous gift. We cried out, too short! Too short, God, you didn't give him enough breath. Too short, we cried out. But long enough to touch the hearts of every pastor of the Lutheran Church in Nebraska. They were all there. Too short, we cried out. But long enough to touch the lives of every family in that small town, as they were all there to speak an Easter word. Too short, we cried out, for the children. But long enough to be loved by every person and to love every person in that town. Too short, we cried. But long enough to adopt every stray cat in that whole town, lived in that house with his family who adopted everybody. Long enough for us to learn about Easter. There are things that just knock the breath out of us. It takes a lot of breath to shout hallelujah the end of the school year. It takes a lot of breath to say, I forgive you. It takes a lot of breath to receive forgiveness when relationships are broken. The hardest time I had once, funny story it seems, my son, who's now a junior at Lenore Ryan College in Hickory, was probably about 7 or 8 years old when this happened. I came home, as a pastor, I came home, someone dropped me off. And there was my son standing right by my 280Z that I prized. And he was standing, and he had no breath in him. Tears splashing down his little flat cheeks. His body was going. And I said, and I knelt down. I said, "Kent, what's wrong?" He said, "Daddy, I did something really bad. I mean, it's really bad." And I said, "You know, typical father, you think you know all this stuff and you can handle everything. It can't be that bad." I put my arms around him. He said, I was playing and I was going in and out of the other car, and I opened the car door and I put a big dent in the other car. And he says, "It's really bad. It's really bad." I said, "Oh, it can't be that bad. It can't be that bad." Thinking that he did this to my wife's car. And just then he steps aside in front of where all the paint was scraped off of the fender of my prize 280Z. And I look at it. I've only given it my life. And there, it's dented, and the paint is gone. This precious paint that is a special blend that I designed with this company and paid them my life earnings for this, it was gone. "It's really bad." "It really is bad, Kent. It is really bad. I didn't know it was the car. I thought it was just the car." Breath in my overreaction to be able to hold him in my arms and say, "It's only a car." It takes a lot of breath to forgive people from other things that you prize so much and maybe lose perspective with. It takes a lot of breath to receive forgiveness. I remember it took me another evening before I asked my son for his forgiveness. It took every bit of breath I had to get down on my knees so I could see him eye to eye and say, "I was wrong. Will you forgive me? You are who I cherish. I was wrong." And for him to say, "Well, of course." That's what our family is about. Receiving that forgiveness, it was the arms of Jesus. That's this text. Jesus breathed on them. I always thought that was so funny. Comes and goes, "Hi." You know. But the whole idea of that breath is that life-giving breath. Even that, you know, the Hebrew, ruach, it sounds like God throws up, doesn't it? Ruach, that whole breath, it is that breath that gives life. It is that breath that Jesus breathes on them. It is a breath of fresh air. It is a breath of fresh air for Easter people like you who are going so fast, and you've got so many things to do before you finish this academic year, and there's so many things required of you, and there are relationships, and there's your family, and there's brokenness, and there are gaps, and there are holes, and there's pain, and you're expected to come here and sing a good Easter hymn and shout hallelujah and to be forgiven and to forgive. How do you do that when you're out of breath? You simply rest in the arms of your God and let Jesus in the Word, in your baptism, in Holy Communion, breathe on you and restore ruach, life-giving breath, so that you can be an alleluia to one another. Rest in the arms of Jesus. It is a breath of fresh air.